to this wonderful meeting, and my job has been rendered very, very easy because of such good speakers that have preceded before me. They have explained so much about why which model organism is useful for which purpose that my job becomes really, really easy. So I'm going to go a little bit slow on that account because you have already heard about many of the things that I'm going to talk about. And I'm not going to emphasize any more about why development or why model organisms, because that has been extensively done. So the model organism that I'm going to talk today is rather an unusual one because it's not very popular. Unlike the worms or the flies or even the fish, you don't normally, even the fish, because that's the youngest one, right? Chick is even more rare as a model organism, but I think it is the oldest because it goes back to the time when developmental biology was thought of as embryology, and you'll see in next few slides why I said so. So this is what you normally, you know, associate with eggs or chickens. When you think about it, those of you who are non-vegetarian would think about omelets or legs or drumsticks or something like that. Most of you have not thought of chicken being a model organism, and that too for developmental biology. But let me tell you differently. So this goes back really way back in time to Aristotle. So Aristotle was an ancient Greek thinker and scientist who was there around 300 years before the birth of Christ. And he, at that time, did something which was just mere observation. He didn't even have a microscope or know anything about genes or any such things. All he did was open up the chicken egg at different times and observe the embryo. And then from his observations, he wrote several books, not only about chicken embryos, but about all animals and how they form, how they develop. And some of that has formed the basis of modern day developmental biology. So this image shows you a series of stages of development of the chick embryo that any one of you could do. All you need is an incubator, because you can't get a mother hen. You can substitute a mother hen by an incubator that is maintained at 38 degrees centigrade, and you can just put a fertilized chicken egg into it, and it will just be on autopilot and develop on its own. You don't have to do anything. And at the end of it, it will hatch out into a chicken. So I'll take you through that journey through another video that I'm going to show. And you can appreciate how beautiful it is. You start with an egg, and it takes about 21 days for it to hatch. So in the very beginning, it just looks like a dot. And then there is a disc. In the disc, there's a line, which is called the primitive streak. It starts to develop into what looks like an embryo. And then there's the heart that starts beating. It develops a network of blood vessels. Takes all its nutrition. It's a self-contained system in the egg. The entire development happens there. So all the nutrients are already provided by the mother. So different organs are forming at this stage. And then you can see how it slowly is becoming bigger. And then beak development happens. These are all morphological features that we use to identify what stage of development has been attained by the embryo. Then you see feathers coming up slowly. And then the mouth opens. And then claws come up. And then these are all features that we mark as so many hours of development or so many days of development have happened. Eyelids will form, they'll close the eyes, and then it starts to turn. All this time it's in the shell. The shell is porous to oxygen, so it is able to get oxygen from outside. And the gut goes into the abdomen, and now the feathers have covered the body. Now it's getting ready to hatch. So it will do a little pip and break the eggshell. And there comes out the chick. So in the lab, we don't normally go to this, we don't go up to the end. We try not to go. There are some accidental hatchings that may happen, and we then send back the eggs, the chick, to the poultry farm for the next generation. So, No. See, we make a distinction between food and model organisms. Try not to eat our model organisms as far as possible. So this fascinating process of development, of course, is what we are all trying to understand, that how from a single cell, which everyone showed in their slides, that is the zygote, we go to a ball of cells, which is called the blastula. From there, I have not shown the intermediate steps, but a lot of changes in cell number and cell movement happens, which gives rise to gastrula. And then you get the fetus, in case of humans, which continues to develop over a long period of time until the infant is born. And the infant development doesn't stop there in humans. It keeps on continuing until you become an adult. Right? So the hallmark that happens through all of these stages is growth and differentiation simultaneously. And then the questions that all developmental biologists want to know is, how does this happen? How is this growth and differentiation happening hand in hand and coordinated in such a beautiful manner? So for that, I'll go back again in time to the zygote. From the zygote, we got to the blastocyst. This is just cell division. There is nothing more than cell division happening at this stage. And after that begins the process of the all-important gastrulation, where these cells undergo movement. And I don't have the beautiful movies that she had of the movements themselves, but in the chick too, the same kind of movements happens, and this becomes flattened into a disc-like structure. And the disc has the three germ layers which are laid out. The topmost one is called the ectoderm, the middle one is called the mesoderm, and the last one is called the endoderm. So this is the first step of differentiation. So before this, all cells pretty much looked the same, and they were also same if you look at them at the level of the genes or the molecules that they have. But here some differentiation has already set in. Now this will undergo a lot more changes, which will ultimately result in developing organs, and different parts of the embryo will start to emerge. Okay, so the kind of questions, two kind of fundamental questions can be asked at these stages. First, which cells move where to form the three germ layers? And Srilaja very beautifully showed that in the zebrafish, you can take cells that are labeled with dyes and you can put them together and you can follow them in the live embryo to see where they're growing. In the chick, it was not easy to see labeled cells in the live embryo, although you can do that. I will not talk about the dye labeling experiments that were done in chick. I'd rather talk about the other experiments which were used to address this question, which germ layers give rise to which tissues and organs. So this is the question that I will allude to in my future slides. Okay, so why the chick embryo? As I said in the very beginning, you don't need anything to see it. You don't even need a microscope. So you can see the entire process of development by simply cutting a window in the egg. You take a bit of plastic tape, stick it on top of the shell so that it doesn't break, and you cut a neat little round window and you remove the shell. And then you put another piece of transparent tape on it so that it doesn't dehydrate, and you put it back into the incubator. And you can take it out anytime, look at it, and again put it back into the incubator, and it will continue to develop into the full chick. So therefore, it is accessible from day zero. Unlike the higher organism that we are going to talk about next, which is the mouse, which develops inside the mother. So this is the main advantage of the chick, that you can not only look at it, you can also do a lot of manipulations. So by the scissor there, I've shown that you can do surgical manipulations. And because of the large size of the chick embryo, it is possible. All the other organisms you've heard so far, their advantages were that they were tiny, and therefore you could keep a large number of them. Here the advantage is you can do surgery, because you actually can manipulate the embryo this big enough. Also, It's also accessible for labeling cells with dyes. And also we can do genetic manipulations, which I've not mentioned yet. So before I tell you about how we do these things, I'll give you a little bit of insight onto one particular process and development of one particular structure, which is the primordium for the nervous system. Okay? So this is called the neural tube. So at the very, very early stage, it looks like a disc, a flattened disc of those three layers that I just showed you. And what you get is just like a line in the middle, which is called the primitive streak. So this primitive streak is just like a little depression in the middle. And cells are going through this and migrating. And initially, it was actually two layers. And then the third layer forms in between, and it becomes a sandwich of three layers. Right? Then what happens is a process called neurulation. So this topmost layer, if you remember, was the ectoderm. Now, there is already specification. The middle part of it is going to become the nervous system. And the sides are going to become what is going to become the skin. Right? So what happens to this middle? It actually undergoes these series of events where it folds. So if you imagine a sheet of paper or cloth, and you push it from both sides, what will happen? It's going to dip down in the middle. Right? This is exactly what is happening there. You can see in those pictures. The sheet of cells is just pushed from two sides so that it dips down. And the edges of the two folds, they sort of come together. What will happen when they fuse is you will get a top layer, which is continuous, and you will get a hollow cylinder underneath. So this hollow cylinder, which extends from the top to the bottom, is the entire nervous system that is going to form from here, the entire central nervous system. The front part of it will form your brain, and the rest of it is going to form the spinal cord. Right? So the reason I told you is this. The transplantation experiments, which can be done in the chick very easily, were done to figure out the origin of the cells that give rise to the neural tube. Where are they coming from? So at the early stage, when none of this has happened, the gastrulation process is just beginning. At that stage, if you take the top layer of the cells, you don't know what they're going to give rise to. Different positions may give rise to different things. So what they did is they used a very cool trick. So this was pioneered by Nicole Ladurin. So what is there is the quail embryo and the chick embryo, although the adult birds, they look very different in size, but at the embryonic stages, they are very similar in size. So you can replace parts between them. So you can do cut and paste. You can take one bit of the quail embryo, put it into the identical place in the chicken embryo. And why you want to do this? Because you can follow the quail cells then. This is a way of labeling without using any sophisticated expression of dyes or genes or anything like that. You simply take quail cells because quail cells have two characteristics. One, that their nuclei look bigger, they have more heterochromatin. So just by simple staining of the nuclei, you can identify which are quail cells. So this is giving rise to what is called as a chick quail chimera. So what they did is they took this little red bit of cells from the quail embryo, and in the donor, the chick embryo, they removed the same bit of cells and replaced it. Now they let it grow. And then you can either look at the heterochromatin nuclei to know which cells were the quail cells, or you can use an antibody that is only specific for quail. It does not recognize the chick protein. So that you can label, and in this neural tube, you can see this is a cross section of the neural tube. So that neural tube has formed, and you just cut it in the middle like this, and you get this cylindrical structure. You see, those cells have come from the quail in this chick embryo. Right? This is how people identified which tissues come from which part of the embryo at early stages. So this would have given rise to the fate map, which has been built up over many, many experiments. Also, I would like to explain to you another example of how this kind of transplantation experiments were used in the chick. So when I told you that the neural tube is forming, what I didn't mention at that stage is that there is this which one is the pointer?
The pointer towards you.
Oh, sorry. Okay, so this is the neural plate, and when it is folding, it is having these regions which are at the edges, right? So when it fuses, these cells which are at the edges do not form either a part of the future skin nor a part of the future neural tube. They kind of separate out. And they are actually called as neural crest cells because they came from this two edges, the crest of the neural tube. And these neural crest cells give rise to a lot of other things other than what comes from the basic germ layers. So they give rise to neurons, they give rise to the pigmented cells in your skin, melanocytes, a lot of things. So if you wanted to know what is the origin of the enteric neurons, okay? The enteric neurons means the neurons that surround your gut tube. So you have a nervous system which is the central nervous system which comprises of your brain and spinal cord. And then you have other neurons which are there around your internal organs which can control the functions of those internal organs, right? So there is something around your gut which helps in the motility of your gut, controls the contractions of the gut muscles, right? The smooth muscles there. So that is derived from the neural crest cells. How did people come to know this? So they did an experiment where they took one chick embryo which was entirely labeled with a fluorescent molecule called green fluorescent protein. So how this green fluorescent protein was introduced into the chick embryo, I'll tell you later. But imagine that it was introduced and the entire chick embryo is labeled with it. So they took a section of the neural tube from this part and they took another chick embryo in which they transplanted it. Now then they let it develop. And once they let it develop, then they cut a section of the animal right through the middle. And you can see the neural tube from that part is coming from, of course, the neural tube here. So it is labeled in green. But what you see are these green dots here. So this is the gut tube actually, below the neural tube. If you cut your cross section through here, you will see the neural tube and then you will see the gut tube below it, right? So the gut tube has these surrounding green cells which are around the gut which make the enteric nervous system. So they could say that it came from the neural crest cells from this region, right? Now comes the question of, okay, so we can observe that different cells are coming from different positions in the early embryo and they're occupying different other positions in the later stages. But ultimately you want to know which genes are doing this, which genes are controlling the process of growth and differentiation. So to do that, we have two strategies in the chick. We can do, as in other organisms as well, we can do gain of function. As Lolitika said, you put a gene where it is not there, or you activate it, or loss of function, lose it. You can lose the gene function, okay? So how do you do gain of function? You can either do increase the amount of the gene expression or change the place where it is expressed. That is called ectopic expression, meaning it's not there in that place, you just put it there, okay? And then the opposite would be for loss of function, you inhibit the expression of the gene. You don't allow it to make a protein, okay? Or you inhibit the function of the protein itself, okay? So that can also be done. So both these kind of approaches have been used in the chick quite successfully. I'll give you some examples of these. So to go back again in history, what you can do in the chick is you can do a technique called as bead implantation, which is again possible because you cannot, this is a large size of the embryo. It's not possible in other animals. So what you do is you take a bead, a small microscopic bead, few microns, and then you soak it in the solution of a protein or a chemical that inhibits a particular gene function, okay, or activates a particular gene function. So you can do it with proteins or with chemicals. And then you put it in the chick embryo. Because it is so accessible, you can surgically implant that bead wherever you want. It will release that compound and that will affect the surrounding cells and you can see what is the effect of that, right? So this was very famously done using a molecule called retinoic acid. Now retinoic acid is derived from vitamin A, which we get from our diet. And then in our body, there are two enzymes. One, the vitamin A is an alcohol, so it's called retinol. So it needs a dehydrogenase, which converts it to an aldehyde. And then another dehydrogenase converts it to retinoic acid. And that is the functional molecule that works, right? So what they did is Somerville, in his laboratory, they took the chicken limb bud. So at the very early stage, you saw in the movie that I showed you, the limb develops as a bud initially. There's just a bud along the flank. So if you make a cut in this, and they didn't have very sophisticated things. So guess what they used? They just used newspaper. They took a piece of newspaper and they soaked it in retinoic acid and they implanted it into the limb. This is the developing limb bud. This is the head of the chick embryo. I'm sorry that it looks darker on this than on my screen. So here is this white piece of newspaper which has been stuck in there with retinoic acid. And then what happens later on? So when this whole limb gets developed finally, you see these are the digits. This is the wing disc. So this is up here. So it has this kind of digits that are there in the wing. But you get a mirror image copy. So this experiment is curious, one, because they use newspaper, and that too, they found a particular local newspaper which would work. They tried the London Times and it didn't work. So that tells you that there are some really quirky things that can happen. So this Richmond and Twickenham Times is the only one that worked. And then they were able to see this. And this showed you that retinoic acid is important for patterning the limb, actually. The reason that you get this pattern of digits, you always have your pinky on this side and your thumb on this side. You don't never have it the other way around, right? Yes? It's possible, but they did it with dummy also. They took the newspaper, they did a control experiment in which there was no retinoic acid and they didn't see this effect.
What were the problems with other
newspapers? I mean, they were not able to probably absorb the retinoic acid and release it properly, right? So other experiments of using beads, and this time it is soaking a protein called fibroblast growth factor. So this was a very cool experiment that showed you that position has a very important role to play in determining which kind of limb will form. Okay. So previous experiments had shown people that if you take a limb bud and you can transplant it here, a limb will grow from there. So what is it that is there in this limb bud that makes a limb form? Right. So they tried to replace it with various proteins and they found that FGF, if you just take FGF and take a bead and soak it in that and put it, it is enough to substitute for a limb bud. A new limb bud will form wherever you put this FGF bead. Okay. So then what they did is they took this bead soaked in FGF and implanted it in the flank of a chick embryo at this stage, which has two normal looking limb buds already there. The normal hind limb and forelimb is there. But if you put the FGF bead in the middle, it makes a new limb bud. But then after it grew out, there was something strange. What would be the identity of this limb? Would it become a forelimb? Would it become a hind limb? Because it is right in the middle. So it actually became a hybrid limb. The top half of it looked like the wing, and the bottom half of it looked like the hind limb. And then they did further experiments where they moved it closer to the forelimb or they moved it closer to the hind limb and they got either a complete leg or a complete wing or a half a leg or a half a wing. So this kind of experiments also show you the power of bead implantation that you can use in the chick. How much time do I have? I started late. 5 more minutes? I'll be quick. Okay. So now we are coming to manipulations of genes. So although we cannot do what is known as classical genetics in the chick, you can manipulate genes. The way we manipulate genes is by introducing gene expression vectors into the chick embryo. So we can introduce it through two ways. One very classical way is through electroporation. So because DNA is negatively charged, if you inject some DNA which has a construct that is expressing your gene of interest, you can put an electric field around it and the positive electrode is on one side and the negative electrode is on the opposite side and you have, there is an empty space here. So this is also a cylinder, this is the neural tube, right? So you have filled up the head region with your DNA solution, right? And now you apply this electric field and negatively charged DNA will move towards these cells which are on towards the positive electrode because they will be attracted in this direction. So you, in the same embryo, you have a control site which is not electroporated, and you have a site which is electroporated with your construct that is expressing your gene of interest. And if you pair it with another construct, mix in another DNA which expresses GFP, often 90% of the cells will take up both. So you can substitute, you can say with surety that if a cell has GFP, it also has your gene of interest. So here is what the embryo will look like at a later stage, because the forebrain got, the middle part of the forebrain got the GFP along with your gene of interest. And then you cut a section through this, you can see the cells have actually started to express GFP, and they will also express your gene of interest. But the limit of this technique is that it will eventually, it's a plasmid that you have put there, okay? So it's extra genomic, it's outside the genome, and cells will divide, and the plasmid will get diluted with successive cell divisions. And you can only do this, see the effect of this for a limited number of time. You can't see it after a certain stage because it will be diluted out. So then how do you get over that problem? So that problem you can get over by using a different vector. So this time we want to use a retrovirus. So all of you have heard of HIV, and you know that HIV is a retrovirus. So this retrovirus has a genome that is made up of RNA. So here is an example where we are going to look at what Subramaniam talked about in his first lecture, the central dogma that DNA makes RNA, RNA makes protein. Here is an example where you get RNA to DNA, which is the reverse process. So this genome of this virus, the virus looks like this. It has its genetic material, which is RNA inside. It has a capsid. And then it has an envelope which is made up of the membrane of the cell from which it came. Okay. So now if you look at the genome, it has two long terminal repeats which are actually very strong enhancer promoter combination. So whatever gene is present here will be very strongly expressed. Okay. Now these are the viral genes, and this, there is space enough so that you can insert your gene of interest, right? Now what you do is you infect cells with this construct, and virus will be generated, virus particles will be generated in culture, okay? And this is an avian specific retrovirus, meaning these retroviruses cannot infect any other cells like human cells or mouse cells or whatever, only bird cells they can infect. So you can use this virus preparation and you can inject into the cell, into the embryo, and there are two ways by which this virus is going to spread. One is called the vertical spread, which means that this virus will infect the cell, its RNA will be converted into DNA, and the double-stranded DNA gets integrated into the genome of that cell. It's permanently there in that cell, and whatever gene you have will be expressed by that cell. Because of the LTR, it will be permanently expressed. This whole thing, this whole cassette gets incorporated into the genome. Now, what will happen? The cell divides and all the daughters get it. And they keep on getting it. So, in this way, you can also do lineage tracing. If a single cell got infected with a virus, you can see all the daughters will be labeled with that gene. So, if you use GFP or something like this here, you can see all the labeled cells. The other way the virus spreads is called horizontal. So, if you have a group of cells, the only criteria here is they have to be dividing. Because this process of integration only happens when the nucleus opens up. When does the nucleus open up? During cell division. So only in dividing cells can you get the process of integration to happen. So if you have a group of cells, and the embryo is a perfect place for this. All cells are dividing, right? Yeah. So you get one cell to infect, it gets integrated, makes virus, releases it outside. So the cell doesn't die. If it makes virus, it becomes a virus making factory, keeps on releasing viruses, and these will infect the neighboring cells. The neighboring cells will integrate it in the genome. Oh, so this is unlike the bacterial system. So there is a way the membrane buds out, and that is the envelope. So this is the envelope that contains the host cell membrane and some proteins embedded.
Host cooperates with direct cells.
Yes. So we all have retroviruses embedded in our genome actually. So here is how it will spread. So in fact, if you put in this virus at an early enough stage in the embryo, you can infect almost the whole embryo. Because it will keep on spreading, all the cells are dividing, and it will become a virtually transgenic animal because you have got your gene of interest into every cell. Of course, we can do this in a little bit controlled way by targeting the injection to specific sites. Since we know the fate map, we kind of know which area is going to form which structure. So we know that the limb field is here, the hind limb field is here, although there is no limb yet. So if we do the viral injection over here, we can also play with the titer of the virus, high amount or low amount. That will dictate how many cells get infected. So this shows you that the hind limb is fully infected with the virus. This is a particular antibody which is directed against the coat protein of the virus. So all virally infected cells will show that. So again, this is another example. You can target it to the eye if you want. So this is a retina. If you take out the retina from the eye and you flatten it, it looks like this. And this brown staining is the antibody which shows you all these cells have been infected with the virus and thus with the gene of your interest. So you can overexpress or misexpress your gene as you want. Then RNAi has been introduced several times already, so I will not go into it. But RNAi has recently been adopted in the chick as well. So all this time I was telling you only gain of function, how you overexpress a gene, misexpress a gene, put a bead, surgically manipulate. But you can do loss of function as well through RNAi. So you make a double-stranded hairpin RNA which targets your gene of interest and it can cause the degradation of your gene of interest. And this has also been done successfully. This particular gene is expressed again in the retina in the central part. This is the normal expression pattern. If you infect it with the virus expressing the RNAi, you lose the expression of the gene. See how light it has become? And this correlates with how much of virus infection that has actually taken place. So now is the last slide. How does the chick compare with other model organisms? So what you see here is in certain aspects, the balance is tipped towards the chick, favors the chick. You for gain of function strategies. You can do very good gain of function studies. You can do a lot of surgical manipulations, which you could not do. You could do bead implantation based functional modulation of genes, which you could not do in all these other model organisms. Although you have not heard about the mouse yet. I didn't want to advertise that fact. And then, but on the other hand, the other organisms might be better for loss of function strategies. Although we have started using RNAi, and even now this CRISPR-Cas technology, which is the latest technology to do gene knockout, has been tried in the chicken, and it is possible to do. You cannot do what is called mutagenesis screens like you did in C. elegans or in Drosophila because large numbers cannot be generated. This is a big organism. You can't grow them in your lab because it will occupy a lot of space. You will need a big chicken coop to, you know, get enough chickens. So, and gene knockout can of course not be done like in the mouse. I hope Raj will tell you about it. So I end here. Thank you for listening. We don't need ethical clearance simply because of the fact we limit ourselves to the egg. Oh. We don't let them hatch. Oh. We are not dealing with live chickens. Oh. I mean hatched chickens.
Just don't give them ideas. Right.
So far we have been under the radar. Any other questions? Special variety? Yes, we use white leghorn chicken. There is a Central Avian Research Institute in Bareilly. So they have this particular strain. So the reason why we use the white leghorn is because of the virus. So if we use any strain of chicken that we can get from anywhere, it is okay for all other techniques except the virus. Because they have some endogenous viral infections that are already there. And if a cell is already infected with a retrovirus, then it cannot be super infected. Okay. So we need what is called as a line zero, which has no retroviruses in it. And this white leghorn is that.
Is the chick genome fully sequenced?
Yes. It's not fully annotated, but it has to be.
Same. I'm asking because with CRISPR-Cas you will need.
Yes. It is sequenced.
And it is also useful for the poultry industry, as we call it. There's a big push for that.
Okay, let's thank Jonaki for this wonderful talk.